Now, our first speaker today is someone who has been in Cairo over the last week and an eyewitness to these events. Will you please welcome one of the officers of the Stop the War Coalition, Judith Orr.
Yes, I was lucky enough to spend 4 days in Tahrir Square this week. And I have to say, I mean, I've been a revolutionary for, you know, over 25 years, but to actually witness a revolution taking place in front of your very eyes. What I saw on Tahrir Square was the most inspiring and humbling experience. And I think that when you met people who had faced bullets, who had faced tear gas, who had faced armed thugs in every sort of repression you can imagine in the last days, and yet they held out. It was absolutely inspiring. And I spoke to a socialist who's still in the square this morning, and he said more people stayed the night in Tahrir Square last night than at any other time since the revolution began. People told me, we have lost our fear. Mubarak used to hold us down, but we have lost our fear. And that was shown everywhere. The banners hanging around the buildings. The army tank that still had soldiers on it with "Fuck Mubarak" spray painted on its side. And everywhere you went, people had homemade placards. They weren't placards like we have today. Everybody made their own. Or they spelled out "Go" in Arabic in humans on the square so that the army helicopters could read it as they went past. And everywhere you have an effigy of Mubarak hanging from the traffic lights. You have the Al Jazeera on live on a massive banner made of sewn together sheets so people can watch. Because when I was there was no internet, there was no email, there was no Twitter. The only thing we had was word of mouth about what was happening everywhere. And yet they still got 4 to 8 million people on the streets on Tuesday. It was an absolutely magnificent achievement of self-organization. And throughout it, people kept sweeping the square. There was food, there was water shared, there was security, there was doctors in their white coats giving out limited medical supplies because the pharmacies were running low, but yet everything was shared because they felt that sense of solidarity. But there was politics and arguments and debates, but there was also music and poetry. The sense of solidarity in that square, the sense of a whole city in that square, they took it over and they were running it for themselves. It was an absolutely wonderful sight. But I want to say one thing. When I came back to England on Wednesday night, I see the media obsessed with only one thing, not the Egyptian people taking power into their own hands, but Islamism. They're horrified, aren't they, at the idea that there might be Muslims in government, that there may be the Muslim Brotherhood saying that that Muslims should mix and all the rest of it. The idea of Islamophobia is at the heart of what the media are saying about the Egyptian revolution. And I think we have to say, do Muslims not deserve democracy as well? Are they not allowed to vote for who they choose? I think we have to take a really hard line on this. Because the US and Obama seem to think the only democracy that the Egyptians are allowed is ones that are given by the US. Everywhere I went, there was placards of people saying, we don't want foreign interference. We want to make our own revolution. And I think when you look at the tear gas made in the USA, when you look at the bullets made in the USA, when you saw the jets, they flew low. We were terrified. They flew so low, there was a sonic boom through the city. People said, this is what they do to the Palestinians every day. They will not frighten us. But that is what US money is being spent on the arms to keep the people down. Two points I want to make. One is women are at the center of this revolution. All this nonsense about we're going to Afghanistan to give women's liberation at the point of a gun and bombing people. There is women's liberation happening in that square. Women wearing the hijab or the niqab or neither are part of this revolution, and it's a tremendous sight to see. It was absolutely magnificent. And I saw on the television when I came back, young women breaking rocks to help fight back Mubarak's thugs. That's women's liberation, and they're making themselves their own history in that square. But I think my final point is, they're not broken, they're still fighting, and they're a beacon of hope, not just in Egypt, but across the Arab world and across the globe. We need to give them solidarity. We give them solidarity here, but I tell you what, one bit of good solidarity would be, why don't we try and bring down our own government, the warmongers and the cutters. Let's do that. Victory to the Egyptian revolution.
Thank you very much, Judith. And one thing that does connect deeply all these events is Islamophobia and Muslim baiting, the disgraceful attacks made by David Cameron today, speaking in Munich, and of course the EDL march in Luton. And I'm sure we'd all here today like to send our solidarity to the anti-fascist demonstrators who are confronting the EDL and the police in Luton today. Now, over the last week, as part of its desperate effort to stay in power, the Mubarak regime has been systematically attacking journalists trying to bring the truth out of Egypt about what's happening in Cairo. I'd now like to welcome to speak to you Donaher DeLong, a vice president of the National Union of Journalists, who'll talk about what's been done to journalists by the Mubarak regime. Donaher.
Obviously, Judith mentioned some of the way that the uprising in Egypt is being reported over here. But what we've got to remember is the reason we know the real story is because of other journalists. There are hundreds of journalists from all around the world in Egypt at the moment, from lots of different perspectives, from lots of different organizations. But the one thing that unites them is that they are all under sustained attack by the Egyptian state. The Committee to Protect Journalists has counted 101 attacks on journalists of many different kinds. Some of them have been attacked at knife point by some of the government's thugs. Others have been arrested and detained. One journalist, an Egyptian journalist, was shot a week ago trying to cover the demonstration, and he died yesterday. So I'd like for us all to join in solidarity with Ahmed Mohamed Mahmoud, who was killed and died yesterday as one of the first journalistic victims of the regime. Let's hope he's the last victim of it. But we've got to remember that this is still going on. Only yesterday, Al Jazeera, which I'm sure virtually everybody here knows, has been giving the truth and reporting it. Everyone's been glued to Al Jazeera to find out what's been going on. Yet their offices were closed by the regime on Sunday. Only yesterday, the head of their bureau, based in Cairo, was arrested along with one of his colleagues. The state is still trying to shut down the message, still trying to shut down the truth. And it's not just professional journalists. We've also heard that they've tried to shut down access to Twitter, access to Facebook, access to all of the things that are allowing the ordinary people of Egypt to get their story out and challenge some of the things that are being reported by others. So this is what's important. It's not just about the professionals. It's not
that all is well in Egypt, that this is a moderate regime. This was and remains still now, about to be overthrown, we hope, a brutal dictatorship kept in power by the Egyptian military. Don't forget that. Without military support internally, Mubarak could not have stayed in power. And the fact that the military itself is now divided, with the generals scurrying to Washington to get orders, but lots of junior officers and soldiers fraternizing with the people, that was the decisive event of this mass uprising, when the soldiers began to fraternize with the people. We have seen it before in parts of Europe, in other parts of the world. We saw it in Iran in 1977 when the army refused to open fire on demonstrators trying to topple the Shah. So what happens over the next weeks is going to be determined to a certain extent on how divided and how split this army is. Have no doubt what the United States would like to